Oh yeah, here we go now.
In part two, Jeff goes all lone wolf and flies, snaps, clutches, hydraulics, and wipes his way to a Keesler 5-speed.
Waiting on back orders again? Your neighbor isn't. He ordered from NPD. National Parts Depot continues to be the nation's leading source for quality restoration parts and supplies for Ford, truck, Mustang, Camaro, Chevelle, and Firebird. With four strategically located superstores, you'll find everything you need shipped to your door within 1 to 3 business days. For your free catalog, visit NPD online or call toll-free. Don't let back orders stall your project. NPD takes the frustration out of restoration.
Welcome to part two of how to install a Keesler 5-speed in your vintage Mustang chassis. Let's get busy. Now our setup on our car is typical of a Keesler setup, and what that means is we're using a standard depth bell housing, which is 6.9, at least for our application, and we're also using a standard Keesler T45 RS transmission with a 26 spline input shaft. Other transmissions? Going to be a little different, and you're going to have to know what your application needs to be. You may be doing this in a street rod and need a shorter bell housing. That's something you'll need to discuss with Keesler. One of the things we want to show you is how to actually set up and measure your bell housing to make sure you've got the right one for your application. Now, what we recommend doing is getting a straight edge, two straight edges actually, and basically lay it across the top. On our application, with it being a 6.9-inch bell housing, quite frankly, you're not going to see a whole lot of difference between 7 inches and 6.9 in a rough measurement like we're doing here. But this will let you know that we do indeed have a 6.9-inch bell housing, and that's going to go just fine with our T45 RS transmission. Now, no matter what you're doing, we recommend using a rollerized pilot shaft bushing in these cars. It's just a lot better setup than the old bronze bushings that you used to use in them years ago. And yes, you can get these in a standard 4-speed size. We like the fact that Keesler includes one of these type of pilot bushings in their setup when they send it to you.
To install that pilot bushing, you're going to need a hammer, a socket that's about the same size as the diameter of the pilot bushing, and some patience, because you're going to be tapping an awful lot. On 6.5-inch bell housings, you're going to need to leave an 1/8 inch space between the back of the pilot bushing and the face of the crankshaft.
Couple of things. When you're looking at a situation like this, the 351 Windsor and the 289 and the 302 all share a common imbalance of 28 ounces, except when you're talking about the 1981 and newer 5-liter engine. That engine actually has a 50-ounce imbalance, so when you're doing a Keesler setup like this, you need to know what your imbalance is when you're ordering your flywheel. That's critical, because if you get the wrong flywheel, this thing will shake like a freight train coming apart. But what we're going to do now is we're going to start installing the bolts, get this flywheel mounted up and ready to go.
You'll want to throw a little dab of blue thread locker on each one of the bolts and then throw them into the holes. After that, you'll use a ratchet wrench to go in and tighten them up, but not too tight. You'll want to put all your final tightening on with the torque wrench. Set your torque wrench to 85 foot-pounds. Then, whenever you've done that, take a screwdriver and run it through the flywheel into one of the holes in the flex plate. This will hold the flywheel into position for you. on a Ford 6-bolt flywheel, use the chart shown in order to achieve correct torque specification on your flywheel.
When you've got your bearing installed, you're also going to want to put some high-temp grease inside the bearing assembly to help it in its rotational job, if you will. Now, the grease we've got says that it's good for GM, Chrysler, European, and Japanese cars, but apparently not good for Fords. We kind of think it may have either been a misquote or whatever, but it's high-temp grease, and it should work on pretty much anything on the planet that needs grease. So we're going to use it here and take the risk that it may not work in our Ford. We know it will work in our Ford. Trust us, the last thing you're going to want in your manual shift installation is junk on the flywheel. You're not going to want any contaminants on there if you can help it. So what we're going to show you is that you need to put some acetone on the flywheel and also on the pressure plate. But more importantly, you're going to want to keep your little grubby, oil-infested hands off either one of those things. And the best way to do that is with a set of nitrile gloves like these. Ow! God, I hate it when I do that. Now, the Ram flywheel that we got from Kiesler is a dowel pin flywheel, and that's pretty good. We like a dowel pin setup because it will locate that pressure plate on the flywheel much better than the old long style with the shoulder bolts. Yeah, they're a little easier, but the dowel pins work great. But you have to install them, and that's what we're going to show you right now.
Use a quarter-inch socket, an extension, and a hammer to seat the dowel pins into the flywheel. Your tapping pattern should be top, bottom, right, left. Top, bottom, right, left. You get the idea, and you'll do this on every single one of them. Always check your clutch disc for any kind of directional information on it. Ours is marked flywheel side, so we know that that side, obviously, goes toward the flywheel. Yes, that's oversimplistic, but sometimes directional information can be overlooked. Yep, more thread locker. And this time you're putting them on the bolts for the pressure plate. Make sure you do this step. Don't miss it, or you'll mess up and be very, very sad. Same idea as the flywheel, different pattern. And make sure you torque these bad boys down to 35 foot-pounds per square inch using a torque wrench. Not your idea of what it might be if you had a torque wrench. Don't have one? Go buy one. Seriously. No need for a ball stud and a hydraulic clutch, so it's out of here.
Now, just to be on the safe side, you're going to want to go in and make a full rotation of the assembly inside that bell housing with everything bolted down. That way you can make sure you don't have any interference problems before you get this assembly inside the car. Well, we're going to have to do a little math here because we're running a hydraulic clutch. And the reason for that is you have to know what the depth measurement is between the face of the hydraulic clutch and the pressure plate. And it has to be about a quarter of an inch. So we're going to show you right now how to get that measurement. Now, in order to get this measurement, we're going to use an adjustable carpenter's elbow. The reason we're using that is because it's got a big, flat bottom on it that will allow us to put it on the pressure plate and basically know right where it needs to sit. So we're going to put that in there now. Then we're going to use a standard carpenter's elbow to get our level with the bell housing. And finally, we're going to use a set of clamping pliers. Clamp everything together and pull it out and take a look. And right now we're at 3¾ inches, and doing the math on it, which you have to subtract 3.325 from the 3.75 measurement that we got out of our bell housing, and quite frankly that shows that we're over the nominal quarter of an inch spacing that you need between the throwout bearing and the pressure plate, which requires a shim, and luckily the guys at Kiesler stock those. Now, these shims really aren't that big a deal. Now, keep in mind that the shims are clocked. There's a certain way they have to go on, the holes all have to line up, and they do all line up. You won't always need to do this. Some applications, this will bolt straight in, you'll get your quarter of an inch measurement between the pressure plate and the throwout bearing, but in our case, and in some of your cases as well, you're gonna need to shim out this throwout bearing. Not that big a deal, and it's pretty easy to do. We're going to show you how to do that right now. You have two bolts, and that's it. That's all that are in here that you need to remove. And what you can do in order to keep things somewhat lined up is leave one bolt in. And it comes with two new bolts. Take it and install it like this. Of course, you have to clock it correctly. And you're in. That's how it works. Very easy to do. Now we're ready to bolt this to the bell housing. Well, that's our show for this week. What we're going to do now is we're going to go out and put a little bit of Eastwood tie coat on our bell housing to tie in with some of the other aluminum stuff in the engine bay. And then next week we're going to come back and show you how to put the engine, bell housing, and transmission together outside the car, then install the assembly into the Mustang. Thanks for watching. We appreciate you being here every week. And please remember, as I like to always say, tell the dog, tell the cat, tell the neighbors, tell anybody to listen, to come and watch us here on Auto Restomod. You can also follow us on Facebook at the little address below. So, see you later. Have a good week. I look forward to seeing you back here next week on Auto Restomod.